holding back, but he wants to go to Jesus? I'm not going to give it away. Of course, he chose it. But we're all in that same position. We all have those chains pulling us back into the world, and Jesus is saying, come, follow me. So, what's your decision? It's not an easy one. This is a break, the past and the future. But you think you're going, if you go towards Jesus, is that better than going back? Huh? That's the decision we have to make. Love you guys.
That's a good point. I was struck by that same part. If the question chosen, that part struck me. I remember talking with Nick, and he said the same thing. You know, just that question, as if I was in Nicodemus' shoes, how would I have done? How would I have responded to the call of Christ to follow? And would I have been strong and faithful, or would I have been afraid? Let's not be people of fear. Let's be people who worship. And I want to invite you guys to stand. Let's worship the one who has saved us, the one who understands our weaknesses, amen, the one who puts up with our weaknesses, who puts up with our doubts, and who loves us profoundly anyway.
I'm just
powerful prayer. Come sing your ruling name in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. I long
to see Jesus working in our church and in our community. I long to see Jesus working in my home and in your homes. I long to see Jesus reaching the lost. And though I don't always see the things I would like to see, I see Jesus now here amongst us. I see Jesus in the beauty of what he's done. I see him in his word and his story. I see him in the way that he ministers to my heart today and every day. Would you read this with me? Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Don't we want that for our kids? Don't we want that for them to know this? If they went to school and are they hanging out with their friends, and they could talk about Jesus, because even though they haven't seen him, they know him, and they love him, and they're filled with joy because of what he's done. Let's pray this over our homes and over our community. Father, we ask that these words would ring so deeply true, that Peter's words would be more of a prophecy over us, proclaiming what is to be in our kids' lives, in our lives, in our marriages, in our workplaces, Lord. That though we do not see you, maybe, Lord, in the ways that we wish and what we would like, but where we know you are there and we love you. We thank you so much, Lord, for what you've done for us. We could sing millions of songs and never thank you enough or give you the praise that you deserve. So, Lord, for our little ones, those who are 6 and under, who are going to the class, Lord, I pray you bless them. For the others who remain with us, help them to sense how good you are. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. So, 6 and under, you are dismissed for children's church commencement. You can remain standing, you can have a seat, you can kneel, you can dance, do whatever you can do. To praise the Lord, we love you. This happened.
Tell me who your favorite superhero is. Here's my number. generally what you do is here's some examples of superheroes you might choose from. You can choose others, preferably somebody from a comic book, your favorite superhero, and then I keep track of that later. So mature in faith. We understand how maturity works in human life to a degree. When we have the men's Mexico work trip, we demonstrate that we're not fully mature to a degree. We have our fun. We laugh a lot. But growing up in our faith, we're talking about essential practices, friends. And these are things that, when I say essential, they are necessary. They're not recommended. Rich has this saying, and I don't like it, when we talk about the speed limit is a recommendation. It's not a requirement, it's a recommendation, right? Yes, yes. Especially for driving a Corvette or something like that. Yeah, the speed limit is a recommendation. These things are not recommendations, they are essential. They're things that God expects, that requires. And I think it's good, just as a good parent expects that their kid will eat and follow orders and those kind of things, and sleep, all the things that we know are helpful for the benefit and growth of the kid, we expect that of our kids because we want them to grow up. We want them to mature. So also, God wants you to grow up. He wants you to mature, and these are some of those things that He expects you and I to do all the time. They increase our connection to Jesus. They are the lifeblood of our connection to Jesus. And they change the world. And you talk about the impact people like Billy Graham, Rabbi Zacharias, others have had. Phenomenal impact, correct? But the impact came through a connection with Jesus and living out the calling of God in their lives, and it impacted the world. Same thing can happen in anybody's life if you put your faith into practice. James says, don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. So we've spent the last 10 weeks talking about prayer, and talking about listening to God and talking to God. And we've looked at that for an extensive amount of time. We did not exhaust by any means what the Bible has to say on prayer. There's so much that the Bible has to say on prayer. However, we're coming to a place where we're stopping there, and we want to stop with our ears open. You know, we want to stop listening. We want to listen to God well. And if we continue to say the same things over and over again, sometimes there's a danger that stuff gets drowned into kind of this murky unity rather than really hearing what God has to say. So let me begin the next practice that we're going to talk about. I don't know how long. I just try to obey what the Spirit says. But how we're going to begin this next practice, and we're looking at it, and it's so important. We actually began it before. You may or may not have been here when we did. But the question that we'll start that with is, what happened the day you were born? The day you were born. We're going to say out loud our birthday. You don't have to say the year. That's okay. You just say the birthday. So I'll say your month and day that you were born on the count of three. So 1, 2, 3. I heard a lot of Decembers. And so clearly that's why you guys are here, because, you know, higher level. Our love was born on December 25th. I was born December 25th of 1976. December 25th of 1976. This was the most popular song of the time. Yeah, this is what my parents listened to on the way to the hospital operation, right? Yeah, let me get that surgery. What's that?
Rich Dancing?
That was Rich Dancing, yes. He was in that video. That was the most popular song, one of the most popular songs in the year 1976, if I could talk. This was the most popular movie in 1976, anybody would guess?
Jaws.
Ship sank and killed 100 people. Not my fault, I don't think. It happened before, I think, my actual time of birth. But what happened on the day you were born? Have you ever looked it up and just said, what was in the news the day I was born? It's a fascinating thing. There's a lot that happens, right? There's a lot that happens the day you're born. One of the biggest things that happens the day you're born is that you join what? The human race. You join the human race. You join, when I was born, there was about 4.8 billion people, apparently. We didn't count. There are about 4.8 billion people on the planet when I was born. Now there's like 7.6 billion or more people on the planet. So we've been fruitful and multiplied as a people as God commanded. But when I was born and when you were born, we joined the large human race. Right? You with me? Anybody descend from that? Anybody not part of the human race? No? Okay, we're good. All right. What else happens is when you're born, for me, December 25th, 1976, I didn't just join the human race. I also was born into a specific family. Born to a mom, and I was born to this stud. Yeah, he doesn't even have to smile for the camera. He just, hold the boy. Hold the boy so I can take a picture. No, yeah, I was born into the Hinderleiter family. And I guess there's my brother, too. Yeah, you gotta count him in there somehow. Some way, we're born into a family, and you were born into a family as well. Now, we're going to stop here for a second because I realize that we're born into a family, we're born into the human race. We're given a home, and we're given a name, right? Not just a first name, but we're given an identity of the last name. And then we also take on family traits. You know, we kind of take on sometimes family hobbies, family pastimes. We take on family preferences. We take on family ideology at times. These are things we are born into. And as I say that, let me also say, no family is perfect. Because every family that I've ever met is made up of humans. Right? And every human I've ever met is imperfect. Correct? Anybody here want to argue? You can argue that your mom or your wife is perfect. You might get yourself some points. But no, we know that it's true that we're all imperfect. We are born into families and no family is perfect. We have our quirks, we have our oddities, we have our sweater vests. That is my family. I don't know if you can see that very well, but I am the lower left chubby one and my hair is parted down the middle and it seemed like a great idea at the time. We are born into imperfect families. So here's the question. What's your story? You know, all of our families are broken. Some people are born, and then because of whatever situations, they're kind of adopted into another family. Some people are born into broken families so much that they really don't understand or know. Some people are born into so much dysfunction that's the identity that kind of they have to carry with them for a long time. Some people are born into families that they'd rather not see or talk to. What is your story? I just want you to take a moment, because when you're born, God has these intentions for you, and yet there's these things that take place in our lives that mold us and shape us. What happened when you were born? What were you born into? What do you carry with you? And I think it's important because there's a second question here. What happened the day you were born again? What happened the day you were born again? Do you know what I mean by born again? The Gospel of John, chapter 3, talks about it. Jesus is speaking with, coincidentally, Rich and I did not work this out ahead of time, Nicodemus. Jesus is speaking with Nicodemus, and he talks about being born again. He says this in reply. Jesus declared, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is, say with me, born again." How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit." Flesh gives birth to flesh. That's the first birth. But the Spirit gives birth to spirit. That's the second birth. You should not be surprised at my saying, "You must be born again." The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. The Bible teaches us that there is a new birth, a being born again. And when we do this, how does this happen? A person puts their faith, firstly, in what God has done through Jesus. In the fact that he lived, brought the truth, and he died, paying for our sins, that he rose again, conquering death. When a person puts their faith in what God has done through Jesus, simple things happen right away. The first thing that happens is that they're forgiven. Do you know that? That if you put your faith in what Jesus has done, what God has done for you through Jesus Christ, you're forgiven of everything. Everything in the past, everything in the present, everything in the future, you are forgiven. It's as if you were atoned for. It is as if God looks at you and sees the perfection of Jesus instead. Romans 3, 22 through 24 is a reference for you to look at just if you want more detail on that. The whole book of Romans, you can look at for more detail on that. When you believe in what God has done for you through Jesus, you're forgiven. You believe that? Receive that? Amen. Also, at the same time that you are forgiven, you are given new life. You are born again, born anew. 2 Corinthians says it this way. Would you read it with me? I always remember this because in Mexico, when I was in high school, we memorized this verse in Spanish. And I didn't know Spanish, but we memorized the Spanish, so we said it. And it was the verse that we used to speak to the communities where we were planting a church. And I remember this old man hearing the story from the pastor and hearing this passage. And this old man who lived a long life and was crippled to a bit, he heard the message and he walked forward. And that day, that man became brand new. Brand new. The pastor used the illustration of a caterpillar and a butterfly, a caterpillar becoming a butterfly. And I think he even had one of each there. He talked about the new creation. Let's read it together. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come." Try not to read it like we're at a funeral, because we're not at Port Royal at a funeral. The old dies, but there's new birth at the same time. Let's say again, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come." So that happens instantly when you put your faith in what God has done through Jesus Christ. Confessing our sins, putting our faith in what God has done through Jesus. And then the next thing that happens is you receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a gift. Peter, preaching to the crowd, says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Repent and be baptized, every one of you, and you will receive forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the Holy Spirit. So what happened on the day you were born again? For me, it was April 7th of 1992. Some of you don't have a specific day. For some of you, your process of transition from the old to new was the sweeping curve of event after event, and eventually found yourself walking in a different direction with the Lord that you didn't know that one day you stopped and turned around and followed. Some people say you have to have that stop and turning point. I don't think so. I think you can have, as long as you are following the Lord Jesus and you are there, you're with him where he wants you to be. On April 7th of 1992, you know what the number one song was? You know? It's a breakup song, but it's a good song. So well done. Do you know what the movie that started off that year as number one was? Has Dustin Hoffman in it? Was Robin Williams? Do you know Billy Roberts. Everybody know? Hook. Hook was a member of, what was the movie at the beginning of that? April 7th of 1992 is the day that I was born again. It was an afternoon, late afternoon, evening, when I was born again. And on that day, I was born into, not the human race, but I was born into the church. And it's a worldwide thing. The church wraps around the world. I have brothers and sisters in Africa, and on every continent, I have brothers and sisters, fathers and mothers, sons and daughters, who are part of the church. There are people all across the globe that are a part of the church. When I go with the people to Mexico, I'm going to visit family. I'm going to visit my brothers and sisters. When I spend time with Greg and Patty Amstutz, I'm visiting mothers and fathers of mine in the spirit and of our team. If I go to Africa, to Rwanda, I visit my younger brother Brad and his wife and their kids who are serving as missionaries there. I can go to Arkansas, as we say in Wichita, Arkansas, and I can visit Tim, and he's my brother in Christ. I have friends everywhere who are part of the church. And when you are born anew, you're born into the church. Capital C, H-U-R-C-H. Capital C, church. You're born into church. At the same time that day on April 7th of 1992 that I was born into the worldwide church, I was also born into a local family. A local church. Lowercase C, H-U-R-C-H. I was born into Linwood Friends Church in Wichita, Kansas. They met in a building called the Dandelion in downtown Wichita. There was about 30 to 40 of us tops. But there was 9 or 10 of us in youth group. And of that group, there's about half of us are in full-time ministry across the United States. I was born into a new family. Essential practices of the faith. When you give your life to Christ, when you believe what God has done for you through Jesus, you are reborn into the church. And make sure you put a capital C on that. Capitalize the whole thing if you want. The capital C signifies the church that isn't in one place, but it is all around the globe. It is the church of those who have gone past and the church that of those who are yet to come. We are born in that church. At the same time, when you put your faith in what God has done through you through Jesus Christ, you are also meant to be born into a local church. And let me use the word geographical. The word that is those who are around you, Christians who are around you. When you give your life to Jesus, you are meant to be born into a group, a family, a lowercase c church of people who are nearby, who are believers and followers of Jesus as well. You're born into that. You're given a new home, a place to worship. You're given a spiritual family. And this is God's desire for every single believer. There is not a believer on the planet that God wants to be isolated and all alone. I know that for a fact. Because of what he says in his word. You're given a home and a spiritual family. You're given a place to grow and a people to grow with. And that is the local geographical church. The church that is around you. Good? Are you with me? Not surprised? Understand? Okay. Let's move forward. We're talking about essential practices of faith. We're talking about these things that increase your connection to Jesus and impact the world in profoundly good ways. Let me do a survey. How many of you think a follower of Jesus should pray every day? Raise your hand. Every day. Every single day? I mean, you don't get a day off? What about Christmas? When you're opening all the presents. By the way, December 25th, I was a pretty good present. Right? Is there a day off that a Christian should not pray? You can answer. No. If you're on your deathbed, should you pray? If you're about to take a test, should you pray? If you're about to fail a test because you didn't study, should you pray harder? Absolutely. If there's somebody in the hospital, should you pray? If there are people in your home that are healthy, should you pray? Should you pray when you're sad? Should you pray when you're happy? Should you pray anytime, all the time? Yes. Why? Because it's something that God wants us to do because it changes the world around us and it connects us to Jesus in a profoundly good way. Can we agree? Okay. If you agree, say amen. Like your Southern Baptist, right? just as we are called to pray, we're called to belong to the body of believers. Not less so, not more so, equally. Just as you are called and made to pray, to go into your home, go into your closet and pray to your Father who is unseen, and transform your relationship with Jesus as you pray, and also transform the world around you as you pray. So also every single believer is called to belong to a body of believers. Globally, you don't have a lot of control over, but also locally. Globally and locally. Just as we are called to pray, we're called to belong to the body of believers. And so the essential practice is to belong to the body of believers. And we're going to talk about that. We're going to unpack that term. We're going to try to defeat a lot of misperceptions, a lot of terminology that isn't correct. But let me just say this. You know, Jesus teaches on prayer. We've just spent 10 weeks looking at it. Right? Jesus teaches on prayer. While he's teaching on prayer, most of the rest of the New Testament, the letters, Thessalonians and Timothy that Rich was speaking about this morning, those letters are written and they're all about how to be a church. So why you talk about the Lord's Prayer and it's not even a full page in your Bible? You can hold up the rest of the New Testament and you say, these are our instructions to believers on how to be the church. Do you think it's important to God? Absolutely. Belonging to the body of believers is essential if you want to grow in relationship with Jesus and you want to impact the world around you. Now, I told the worship team this morning my goal was not to get in the way of the sermon. My goal is not to get in the way. Because as a pastor for 19 years, I definitely have areas of frustration where, you know, you try to do certain things, you try to build and grow, and you run into obstacle after obstacle that really isn't something that should be there. And I run into myself as well. And I hope that you guys grow to have a passion for the body of things that God wants you to. That's the goal today. The prayers of Jesus are answered when the church lives out its calling. Do you know that Jesus prayed for all believers? In John 17, you can look it up when you go home. John 17, you can read the prayer that Jesus prayed for you and for me and every church that ever exists. And his prayers are answered when the church lives out its call. And I don't know about you, when I get to heaven, I want to be able to say, Lord, I answered that prayer you were praying for us. I did my best to try to live out that prayer that you were praying for us. I hope you have that desire too. I want to stand before Jesus and be able to say, Lord, I did all that I could for all that you desire. As Oswald Chambers says, I gave my utmost for your highest. So let's deal with some things that the church isn't. And I promise I'm not going to go on a rant because that's not where we need to be right now. But let's just acknowledge these things. What is the church not? Somebody tell me, what is the church not? A building. You knew, you just picked up the slides? Yeah. The church is not a building. The church, we just painted, thank you. We just had the building painted. Now we might say, you guys painted your church. No, we did not. We did not, but this is a building. The friends call it a meeting house because it's the house where the church meets. It's a building. The church is also not a time slot. Not a time slot. Church isn't something that happens at a certain time and ends at another time. Okay? The church is also not a place you go. If we have this practice saying we're going to go to church, which I'd say that too, I get my words mixed up. I try to say we're going to worship. I think that's more correct. But a church isn't a place you go at all. When we say the church was closed for 5 weeks because of the pandemic, it's a completely incorrect statement, right? The church wasn't closed at all. The church was totally fine. The building was closed. We didn't get together once a week. But the church was not in any way closed by the extent of what the Bible means by church. Church is not a service. Praise the Lord for that. The church, if all church was a time slot, a place you went once a week for a designated amount of time for a specific program or service, if that's all that God had in store for church, oh man, he doesn't have a very big imagination. Church is not a service. The church is definitely not an individual. Just look at those words. I don't know if you can add anything to that. Church is a people. When we look at the first Christians, what did they do? Well, the first Christians, what we know is that they met together daily in the temple courts. When the church first began, and we're not talking about in the year 130 AD, we're talking about the first couple of years of the brand new church. What did they do? They met together every day in a large space. Everybody was a believer, and we know because they kept record of how many people were there, and eventually got too big for the place that they were. And that, isn't that such a terrible problem to have? They got too big. They outgrew the temple courts. So what else did they do? We know that they met together every day in the temple courts. We also know that after that, after their together meeting, then they would go home and gather together with nearby families who lived around them, who also had given their lives to Christ. And they would eat together in one another's homes, they would rejoice, they would pray together, they would worship, they would sing together. They did all these things together in local small groups with those who were around them. Now, if a person, and we know this, that if a person did not have, if they went home and the people who were had also become Christians who were next door to them or whatever, if they didn't necessarily like them, they did not meet with them because they had personality conflict or whatever. Maybe they didn't like the way they sang. They didn't do that. They worshiped together with glad and sincere hearts. How do we know? The Bible tells us. Let's look at Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47. Would you read it with me? It's a big long chunk here. Let's read about the first church. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to the number daily those who were being saved. As you hear the description of the early church, what is a word that rises to the top as you picture this? They sell their possessions and their goods, anyone gives to anyone. They meet together in the temple courts. They break bread in their homes, ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God, enjoying the favor. What are some words that might rise to the top as you hear that? What describes it in the church? Put one word on it. Love. Absolutely. Absolutely. Joy. Hope. And this is what happened. As the good news spread, the church grew. It said not every day they were adding to the number. As the church grew, as the good news spread, the church grew, but also the churches began to develop and grow stronger. What do I mean the difference? The church, capital C, is all the believers. The lowercase c is those who are meeting together locally. And as the good news spread from town to town to town, new churches began. And so when you see the letter to the Thessalonians, it's the letter to the church in the community of Thessalonica. Because all the believers in that area got together and worshiped the Lord and grew in their faith together. So while the big church is growing, all the local churches are growing. Now, if somebody in the Church of Thessalonica didn't really like the leadership of the Church of Thessalonica, they didn't go over to Corinth and go to that church, that was nonsense. I mean, even to make that journey was nonsense. It was all about the local church. They worked through their differences, and they praised the Lord together as he built them up. So we look at the global church. What's the purpose? The purpose of the church is simple. Matthew 28 says that Jesus describes the purpose of the church. If you ever want to know what does it mean to be the church, here's your answer. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. The global church is to take the good news everywhere, and as people believe, to build those people up, and to teach them and disciple them so that they become mature in their faith. What about the local church? Well, that's a global church. What's the local church? The local church is the same. We could do that same thing, Lord, but we're to do it together. And as we do that together, we are to be this family of believers. They are to be called this body of Christ so that we can together grow in our faith and become mature in our faith. All right. Ready for a break? Who are your favorite superheroes? Let's see what I got. I got, and this is dangerous to just all of a sudden look. I got Superman, Batman, Superman. I got two Supermans, a Batman and a Spider-Man, Iron Man and Spider-Man. So now we got a couple of Spider-Mans. We got Thor and Wonder Woman and Superman. Superman's leading now. Spider-Man just caught up, even though this person hates spiders. Wonder Woman, Superman takes the lead, and Sheena? That one. Yeah?
Sheena?
No, it's
Sheena.
She's like
the jungle, like, oh, I don't know who said that. I'm not going to point fingers. If you want to know more, maybe ask the person who knows about Sheena. All right. Those are scary superheroes. What's wrong with superheroes? You've watched, okay, most of you have watched a superhero movie. Have you seen Superman or Iron Man? When it comes to the end, who fights the battle against evil? Superheroes, right? And they win. Do they need a lot of help? Not usually. They're all by themselves. They have these superpowers. Superman, there's cops around all the time when Superman's doing stuff, but they're almost in the way, right? Right? And so we have this problem that exists in our culture, that we kind of elevate superheroes, but we kind of do this to church. And we kind of expect that one or two, or we just think that this is the way it goes, that one or two might have the powers and they're the ones that are going to fight the battle of evil. And we don't want to get in the way. We don't want to be those cops that, you know, accidentally are like, you know, fodder on the side of the road. We don't want to get in the way of that. And so we kind of just watch and cheer on our favorite superhero. Is that biblical at all? No. What is the biblical definition of superheroes and how would they ever fight? I think something maybe like the Avengers, partly because I really like the Avengers movies, but the Avengers is a whole bunch of superheroes, and the only way they're going to win is if they all work together. And friends, that is the illustration dealing with the church. Ephesians says this: so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. That's five different groups of people. But what did they do? To equip his people for works of service. So the people are who? The church. There's this group of people that equip everybody else for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become what? Mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we'll no longer be infants. We ask this question, how do we grow up? Here it is, the answer is right here. We will no longer be infants. How? Tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things what? Grow up into him who is the head. That is Jesus Christ. From him, the whole body, the whole church, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love. And would you read these last, what is it, six words with me? As each part does its work. Is the church built around superheroes, one or two individuals that do it all? No, not at all. Friends, teaching and preaching is only one part of being the church. It's only one part. God has a plan to transform this world through the church. Teaching and preaching, what's happening right now, it's just one part. I'm not going to say it's a tiny part. It's an important part. It's just one part. So you may not feel like you're ever called to preach or teach, but you are absolutely essential to the body of believers. Gathering on Sunday mornings is only a fraction, friends, hear me, it's only a fraction what God has for you and for me and for us. And there are many, many churches gathering on Sunday morning today in this valley. And what we're all doing, oh, that's all good. The teaching, the preaching, the worship, that's all good. But it's only a fraction. What God has is so much more. I long for us to have an imagination, a desire to see what God has for us. Jesus has world-changing work for all of his people. He just said that in Ephesians 4. His world-changing work for all of his people, and that includes you. Would you just take a moment, and you don't have to say it out loud, but maybe you whisper to yourself, or maybe you say it in your head, Jesus has world-changing work for me to do. Do you know that? Do you believe that? Are you making excuses already? Are you saying, no, I'm too old, or no, I'm not trained? Well, what's your excuse? Jesus has world-changing work for you to do. And when you take part of that work, your connection with Jesus will grow, the church will be empowered, and the world around us will be changed. The reality is, friends, is that being the church deepens our relationship with Jesus. My growth as a man of God has come because of others who've poured into me. The Holy Spirit has worked in my life through, I should go back to that picture, we're all standing in front of that man. Those people were so crucial to my growth and development in my early years as a Christian. One of them was my first ever Sunday school teacher. One of them was my first pastor. And the other ones are my first youth pastors. They molded me. The Spirit, let me correct myself, the Spirit molded me through them. God has work that he wants to do in you through others, and in others through you. He wants to impact the world in profoundly good ways. And so this is where I put on my notes, Chris, stop. Stop. Partly because of time. We need to see this. That you are the body of Christ. And each one of you is a part of it. You believe it. Just say it with me. You are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. If you say, I am the body of Christ, and I am a part of it. I am the body of Christ, and I am a part of it. So I'm going to stop here because I want there just to be room for us to pause rather than to go on and to kind of weigh this down or water it down by talking about other things like spiritual gifts and all that stuff. Let's just take time. Let's say we need room for confession. I don't know about you, but for me, my view of church is smaller than God's. I don't like that. I'm a pastor. I'm going to assume that for you, some of you, one or two maybe, your view of what church is smaller than what God has. So let's take a moment and confess that. That Lord, we've taken this world-changing thing and we've minimized it to a time or a building or a specific activity. Let's also have room for celebration. Because friends, I don't know if you've heard this, but God wants to impact the entire world. He wants to do that through you. Did you hear that? That the body of Christ, that the body of Christ, that when Jesus healed and taught and did miracles, all those things that Jesus did, that it's still present in the world, and you are a part of it. Did you know that God thinks so much of his church that you get to do the stuff Jesus did? That's a road to celebrate. That means your life isn't about making a paycheck and then dying rich or poor. There's also room for commitment, isn't there? Say, Lord, if this is your case, if this is what you're saying, if you're saying the church is something that is essential to my life, and not just a Sunday morning, and friends, believe me, by this message, in no way am I saying, therefore, you should never miss a time slot on a day of a week during the year. No way am I saying it. What I'm saying is, are we committed to being the people that God called us to be and empowers us to be through the Holy Spirit? And are you willing to explore what part you may be called to play? Are you willing to explore the part that he may be calling you to play? Does he, if the Spirit is in you, he is gifting you, and he wants to use that to empower others or to win others to Jesus. And that is where it gets really, really exciting. So friends, these are first steps. Let's just take a moment to pray. And rather than jump in and spew out words, let us just take a moment and have a moment of silence, and then I will close us in prayer.